So we're in a never normal, Vivek, in all of this. As we're coming out of this crisis, what would be your message?
The role of HR has increased exponentially because, you know, employment has been disrupted. Your employees are in a state of panic right now. You now have to understand the employees' needs and the trauma that they've been through and guide them from that perspective. And then you've got to realize that you're going to be disrupted also, my friends, unless you understand technology change and understand the new tools and techniques that are available and start understanding everything from what AI enables, which is data analysis and understanding the trends within your company and outside the company, to the new soft types of software that are available. You've got to adapt to the new methods and new processes and upgrade your own services, the services you're providing to the company. Otherwise, you're going to be unemployed.
Technology was the unsung hero in all of this, and HR was the superhero. I can't imagine our world if we didn't have Teams and Zooms. Mind you, I've had enough to last me a lifetime. I'll be right. Very happy to go back to the office.
The HR departments had to get a crash course in Zoom. Most of these people weren't Zoom experts or video conferencing experts. They weren't technology experts. They didn't know about the web cameras, and they didn't know about setting up video conferences. They learned it in a hurry, right? So it's time for them to start learning all the other technologies in a hurry and start adapting to change and being the leader versus being the follower. Mark Zuckerberg and Sheryl Sandberg live very close by. I mean, I used to look up to them and consider them to be good people. Now I go around calling Mark Zuckerberg Darth Vader, that he's turned to the dark side. He's turned evil because he's taken something which was good, social media, and turned it into a force for evil. Imagine if Zuckerberg had focused on using his network to create harmony, to bring people together. The challenge we have with every technology, it can be used for good and it can be used for evil. And we have to do all we can to use it for good so we can create the amazing future we saw on Star Trek.
I know you have email exchange with Elon Musk. I mean, he's the richest man on the planet right now.
I think Elon has gone crazy, by the way. I mean, I used to be a big admirer of his. But, Elon, money and power have gone to his head. And people who would be doing just good end up doing damage to the world.
It's a bit of a conundrum there, social for good, social for evil. It's been a long going conversation for us. What are the opportunities out there for disruption, and who wins here? Is it going to continue being Tesla, Amazon?
What's an EV? An EV is a battery and a motor with a shell around it, right? And of course you need your iPhone or your Android phone in there. That's all it is. So Elon and Tesla made the market, but now with the cost of batteries dropping, the cost of 3D printing dropping, the cost of all these things, batteries dropping, entrepreneurs could be building their own EVs for every country, build their own models, their own designs, and Tesla becomes irrelevant. You could do it for a fraction of what a Tesla will cost because you don't need to have all the high-end features of a Tesla. In most countries, you're happy with a car that goes 40, 50 miles an hour, that goes in the streets, that gets you to work comfortably. If you get that for $5,000 and just plug your iPhone into it, your smartphone into it, and it's powered by your smartphone. You entrepreneurs can build these things right now, and that would disrupt the entire EV industry, right? So entrepreneurs now have opportunities to take the same technologies that have been used to build these $2 trillion companies and to build their own empires from them. And my hope is that they use them for good and not for evil. They use it to uplift humanity, not to destroy it.
Good and evil. I know you do a lot of work for India and you're heading there soon again. Question I would have, China owning all the tech that now sits across India and encouraging India to kind of take ownership for this. Is the next 10 years about trying to bring it home, especially robotics and stuff like that, where cheaper labor in China, for example, has made the powerhouse it is. However, if you bring those manufacturing jobs back home through robotics and AI, does that cool things down in China?
Well, that causes the Chinese economy to crash. And it frees countries from being dependent on the Chinese supply chains. So that's a good thing. I mean, because we need to have independence from China. We can't be reliant upon them and having them blackmail us and countries are afraid of challenging China. The moment they get their manufacturing back, the moment they can do their own design and development of next generation products, they're not dependent on China anymore. But that's what's possible in the next 5 or 7 years. You know, innovations that can make life better for everyone.
On that note, life better for everyone. What are the opportunities for progress in the workplace?
I mean, with these technologies, we can, you know, from an HR point of view, you can now start using AI to understand what's right and what's wrong with your company. So you have tons and tons of data within HR departments. We had, so far, we haven't been able to analyze it. You put it into spreadsheets and the spreadsheets show you something, but AI has a good application over there. You need to get together with some AI people and start looking at the company data and understanding what's going on in the company and how you can understand the needs of employees and make them better. And then you start applying, you know, other technologies. I mean, you know, better systems, you know, being more responsive to their needs. I mean, there's so many different things you can be doing all across the organizations, you know, with technology. Now, this is what HR people should start trying to do, is understand what can we do to make the company more efficient, more effective, and to improve employee morale. You know, doing Zoom calls with the CEO, you know, simple thing might be, and now that we do Zoom, instead of, you know, the types of emails that you would get from the CEO, maybe do a Zoom call with the CEO, you know, once a week, that anyone who has, you know, who's unhappy about something can talk directly to their leader, no matter which location they're in, anywhere in the world, and, you know, hear directly from the leadership. That's, you know, cost-free, basically, and it would improve morale. There are things like that that you can do.
The year ahead for you, Vivek, do you mind me snooping? What does it look like for you?
Mark, you know, I lost my soulmate, my wife, to cancer. And that was devastating for me. I mean, 1 year we fought the battle, we lost it. And then for the last year and a half, I've been in recovery mode. I haven't been able to do anything. In the meantime, what I did do was I learned the problems of the medical system. I learned about medical technology. So I developed a grand plan to cure cancer. I had taken it to Narendra Modi, the Indian Prime Minister, and the Dalai Lama about a year ago. And they were both very excited about it. And Modi wanted to implement it, except the pandemic happened. But in the meantime, a bunch of entrepreneurs, philanthropists, are launching a grand plan to cure cancer, based on what I've said. And they're going to be doing a project that could really help hundreds of thousands of people in the next 2 or 3 years, millions of people over the next 7 years. Get treatments for cancer, and a byproduct of that is going to be cures for cancer. So if I had a choice of what to work on, it would all be on helping you know, these people and on curing cancer, because that's my life's purpose right now, is to cure disease and to make sure that no one suffers the way my wife did. Because my wife said that, Vivek, if my suffering, you know, because what happened was I was talking to her about sharing her DNA and sharing some of the knowledge I'd learned. She said, if my suffering can help others, it would have been worthwhile. So the message she gave me was, help others. And this is what my life is all about now, is helping others. And that's what I want. If I had a choice of what to focus on, it would be to focus on curing cancer and curing every other disease to make her suffering worthwhile.
What a noble cause, though. What a last.
That's what my focus is now, is to cure cancer. And I believe it can be done. Just like, you know, I went on Fox News in April last year and predicted that we're going to have coronavirus cures, vaccines within by the end of the year. And people thought I was crazy. I'm making the same prediction about cancer. I think within 5 years, we can cure almost every cancer. We just need the data. We need the biosamples. We need the platforms for gathering all the information we need and for testing it. And it can happen. And that's what I'm working on right now.
Do you work on any small projects?
We only have the world to save. I mean, literally, we have the world to save, and we have the ability to do it. I mean, you know, if I can think so big, why can't all of the people watching this, whether you're in HR, whether you're in finance, whether you're, you know, a quality assurance engineer, why can't you do the things I can do? What am I? I'm an old guy who, you know, basically, you know, had a heart attack, you know, last year, and was completely devastated. Yet I'm thinking about curing cancer, and I'm talking confidently about doing it. If I can do it, why can't you do amazing things for your community, for the world? All of you have a role to play in taking us to Star Trek and making the world a better place. I have no superpowers. I'm not smarter than anyone else is. I'm not special in any way whatsoever. I'm just an ordinary person. So
I'll have to disagree with you there. An absolute hero. I love this. On that note, I mean, do good. So that's got to be our message. Vivek, thank you so much. An absolute pleasure having you back on the show.
Thank you, my friend.